My name's Harvey Millar. I'm a professor here at the ARC Centre of Excellence in Plant Energy Biology at the University of Western Australia. We're interested in energy biology. Now, that may seem a strange concept to you, but in fact it's the biggest biochemical reaction that runs our world. It basically produces our food, our fuel, the feed for our animals, and the fabrication materials that we use. But in the future, we'll have an increasing demand for all of these things with growing world population. And yet, at the same time, we have increasing environmental concerns, which mean that it's more and more difficult for our systems to provide these things. So understanding energy biology and the efficiency of that process is really critical for the future. We're not doing this alone. We're actually involved in collaborations around the world. So we have collaborations at the Umeå Plant Science Centre in Sweden, at the Salk Institute in San Diego, and Max Planck Institute for Molecular Plant Physiology outside of Berlin, as we work together as a team to try to build our understanding of the energy system in plants and how that can be improved for the future. We think about the lights in our houses and how efficient they might be and how much we might be paying for our electricity. But have you ever thought about how efficient a plant actually is? We look at plants and we see that they use light from the air, they use nutrients from the soil, and they take gases from the air. And so they seem pretty efficient. But surprisingly, a plant's only about 1% efficient in the way that it can take light and convert that energy into chemical energy inside the plant. And of that 1%, only about 10% is actually able to be taken by the plant and converted into products that we want, into food and feed and fabrication materials. That inherent inefficiency of plants arises from the fact that plants gain carbon through photosynthesis, but they lose a lot of that carbon through the process of respiration. You see, plants have to respire just like we do in terms of converting that sugar and that food into energy that actually allows them to grow and develop. Plants respond not just to the quantity of light, but also the quality. By changing the wavelength of light that plants see, we're able to alter the way in which photosynthesis and respiration interact and their rates. We can do that by using LEDs that alter the quality of light so that in a growth room we can have a red light at dusk, we can have a shaded environment, we can have a bright sunny day, all by altering the light quality using a series of different LEDs of different colours. We can also use this technology along with photography to do time-lapse images of plants. And we can use this information to look at the rate at which plants are growing and understand variation between plants in their rate of accumulation of biomass over time. When temperatures rise, photosynthesis starts to plateau, but respiration actually increases. And as temperatures of plants drop, we find that photosynthesis decreases, but respiration stays higher as the cells try to maintain enough energy for the plant to actually live and survive. If we treat these plants with salt, and which is mimicking really a saline environment, what we'll see is that photosynthesis will start to drop, but respiration will actually climb as the plant tries to make enough energy to cope with keeping the salt out. These changes that are happening in photosynthesis and respiration, this balancing act that's happening, is really the efficiency of plants. But this balancing isn't really just theoretically interesting. It's actually fundamental to having sustainable crops for the future, as we live in a world where we have more people, but no more arable land. This respiration process, which is affecting this efficiency, occurs in mitochondria, which are small structures in cells in plants, but also in ourselves. We can purify these mitochondrial structures and actually study all the different proteins that make them up. And so you can see here the hundreds of different proteins from hundreds of different genes in plants, which are actually involved in this respiratory process in mitochondria. And we can analyze these in mutants and look for small changes that are happening in the mitochondria which affect this respiration process. To find out what the proteins are that are changing under those different conditions, we need to use a technique that will link the proteins to the genes that actually encode them. We do that using mass spectrometers. What you can hear is actually vacuum pumps pulling down the atmosphere in these machines so that we can move peptides around in the gas phase. Here we have a peptide, 100 million times the size that the peptides are that are actually in this machine. And what we're doing is measuring complex products like this made from proteins right down to a hundredth of the mass of one of these white protons that we can actually see in this structure. How these machines work is by throwing these peptides in the gas phase up these time of flight tubes and measuring the time that it takes them to come down to the bottom again. In that way, we can build the information about the proteins that are actually found in the samples, link them to the genes, and build databases of how plants are responding to environmental changes. We're also interested in the way in which plants actually respire, not just in what's inside them. To do that, we actually need to measure the respiration rate or the oxygen consumption rate inside leaves. Leaves aren't all the same, so if you look across a plant, you will find that different leaves will be respiring at different rates. What we're doing here is using technology that's been developed to look at cancer cell respiration, to look at plants, and actually taking 2 millimeter circles so that we can look at the respiration rate of each individual leaf in a plant. Because respiration is such a fundamental component of how plants actually operate, we can look at respiration and study it in a whole variety of different plants and compare the findings. Here what we're doing is actually looking at wheat varieties that vary in their tolerance to salt in the environment and in the soil. What we find is that plants can be tolerant or they can be intolerant of that salt. Respiration is also changing, and those changes in respiration are important in understanding the efficiency of different wheat varieties in response to salt. When we think about the design of plants that we're going to be growing in the future and using as food, they're less likely to have a gene from a fish or a spider or a frog in there. They're much more likely to be small variations in what wheat is naturally doing to alter its tolerance to salt. Bringing all the elements of energy biology together to make improvements for the future is a long-term venture. As we move towards 2020 and then on to 2050, as the world population grows, it will be these international collaborations between researchers working together to produce outcomes in field crops that are needed in different countries, which will be vital for the future. The plant biologists have a key role in this right now to actually find the genes which are critical for this process so that we can find the best ways and the best solutions for improving the crops of tomorrow.